Despite being a show about making the most out of every summer day, it's ironic that nearly every episode of Phineas and Ferb followed a simple formula. The titular duo builds some kind of crazy invention, their pet platypus Perry goes on secret agent adventures where he foils the petty schemes of the evil Dr. Doofenshmirtz, Candace tries to get her brothers busted by showing the inventions of the boys to their mother, but Doof's innators cause said machine to disappear right before she can see it. Rinse and repeat for just about 127 episodes, and you've got Disney Channel's longest running series of all time. Since it was on the air for 8 years and lives on today through streaming and reruns, almost everyone has some fond memories with it. I absolutely adored the series after discovering it halfway through its run, but my passion for it didn't stick around through the very end. I can't remember if it was due to my edgy adolescence or a true decline in the show's quality, so today I'm taking a look at the tail end of Phineas and Ferb to see what happened. I kinda sorta watched every single episode again.
Nick.
NICKtendo!
There's 104 days of summer vacation.
It's always made me jealous how unusually long Phineas and Ferb's summer is. Not only does it start at the beginning of June and not around the start of the season, like it always has for me, but it would end in the middle of September. Once I did a little more digging, this 14-week-long vacation made a little more sense. 104 days was supposed to be equivalent to the average length of an animated series, 52 episodes with 2 segments each. Another explanation was that the series was originally planned to take place over multiple summer vacations. Having each season occur during a different year is a great idea, but it would be rather counterintuitive to the show's signature episodic nature. But I suppose change is inevitable when it took 16 years for this cartoon to get onto the air. Dan Povenmire and Jeff Marsh conceived the series during their time as writing partners on Rocko's Modern Life, where they were responsible for creating the award-winning musical episode Zanzibar, which was a sign of things to come. While working as a board artist and director for SpongeBob and Family Guy, Povenmire pitched what would become the series, and Disney picked it up in 2006 after the duo molded it into a story reel. Originally, there wasn't just going to be 2, but 3 different intersecting plot lines, with the third centering around a trio of bugs. They remind me of the bloaty and squirmy parasite characters from Rocko, but we'll talk a little bit more about them later. For now, let's take a look at what will become a Phineas and Ferb, season by season. There's many subtle developmental changes found in both the pilot and across the first season, as the series found its groove and began to tighten itself up. Doofenshmirtz not only had a different name, but his apartment had a more generic design before adopting its signature Ferb head-shaped look. Side characters like Buford and Baljeet would be gradually integrated into the supporting cast, and Phineas's optimistic attitude once came with a bit of sarcasm, clashing with the series' mission statement of trying to be smart without having to make any of its characters outright stupid or unlikable. Season 1's most unique differences come in its look and structure. The character expressions are not very rigidly on model. Movements are slightly more stilted and occasionally repeat animation cycles. There's odd timing issues where sometimes they hang on to one frame for too long. I found a random editing error by accident, and they even experimented with a few photorealistic backgrounds and some CGI animation, which was seldom seen throughout the rest of the series. The animation quality gets a significant bump in the last few episodes, but the visual design is solid from the start. The geometric patterns in the backgrounds give them a unique look, and the characters all have great silhouettes that are unique without looking too bizarre. Just be careful that you don't ever pause whenever Phineas turns around. The pacing of the episodes is a lot more sluggish, even in the story reel that sold the show. It would become the pilot episode roller coaster, but in its original form, it was nearly twice as long. The slower speed and timing is especially noticeable with how the songs were approached in the early episodes. The show didn't even make a conscious effort to include a new jingle or musical number in each episode until Flop Stars. Songs like Busted from I Scream You Scream and My Nemesis from It's About Time are some of my favorites, but if you look at the lyrics to some of their other first attempts, it's obvious that they had to find their footing. I'd say that the series really hit its stride with Dude, We're Getting the Band Back Together. The show proved that it wasn't afraid to switch up the traditional character dynamics to have Candace and Phineas work together, and it's also where the music gets way better than it has any right to be.
You're the one who sets the bar, the hairdo king that fashions are. You're fabulous.
I'm fabulous!
This was one of the first half-hour episodes, and they usually pulled out all the stops for these, taking the characters to space or putting them in a scenario that could have acted as a counterpoint to Candace's goal to bust her brothers if it wasn't a dream within a dream. I've always wondered if the show would have been better off only doing half-hour episodes, since these usually played around with the formula the most, making them the most ambitious and satisfying adventures, but I feel that in any other format, the creators would have gotten burnt out a lot quicker, as so many of the stories they wanted to tell are simple and lend themselves better to bite-sized chunks. As repetitive as it may be, Phineas and Ferb gradually takes advantage of its format after establishing it for its audience. The season finale, Hail Dufania, is a nice example of this, where the tones between the A and B plots are swapped, making it more obvious than ever how they're two sides of the same coin. You got an ambitious triangle-headed scientist, a mute psychic that's occasionally more than he seems, and a teenage girl that tries to spoil their fun to no avail. Maybe this is why Phineas was originally going to be more self-centered.
What you doing? Building a roller coaster. In your backyard? Some of it. Isn't that kind of impossible? Is there something I can do for you?
I sense that the writers got a bit more confident with the stories they were telling. As the set pieces become more ambitious, the premises get weirder, and song lyrics become charmingly specific. The Squirrels in My Pants rap from Comet Chameleon is famous for turning an odd gag into a truly memorable part of an episode. But I think it's great just for all of its random rhymes. Proletariat and Bourgeoisie goes with You Don't Need an Academic Degree, and Government Grants goes with Aunt Florence Living in France. These rhymes would be a lot more stranger if they weren't in a song about squirrels running around in the pants of a teenage girl. Besides the obvious choice, my favorite episode from the season is Traffic Cam Caper, one that not enough people talk about. All the plots converge to craft a unique action sequence that actually has really strong emotional tension, which is rare for this show to achieve in only 11 minutes. My least favorite was The Best Lazy Day Ever. I'm 95% sure that I had seen this episode prior to this rewatch, but I could not tell you a single thing about it beforehand. Its two plots have decent ideas, but the way they merge is rather weak. It is an episode where Phineas and Ferb literally do nothing, so it makes sense that this could have been a lot better. There's plenty of great stuff in season 1 if you're patient enough to see it through, and a charming show does shine through all the rough edges, but season 2 would take what was working and continue to build on it. This rewatch was the first time I had ever seen Phineas and Ferb in order, and I began to notice how strong the world building was if you paid close enough attention. We learn more about the history of the tri-state area, the Fireside Girls, and the organization without a cool acronym. We meet new characters like Irving and his bossy older brother, and see others like Baljeet, Carl, Vanessa, and Coltrane make their way into the spotlight. Who is Coltrane, you may ask? No one really remembers, and he soon joined the ranks of the show's forgotten side characters, like Django and Barack Obama.
You'll be happy to know that we've met all your demands, except for the pretzel thing.
What? How dare you?
Dr. Doofenshmirtz probably gets the most love in this season, as he continues to evolve from a simple supervillain parody to a surprisingly developed and sympathetic loser.
And look here, I wrote big laundry. I don't even remember what the reason was. So I guess I assumed I'd remember, like it was some big genius idea. Big laundry. It's crazy, I'm a crazy person.
He gets to rub elbows with the main cast more often, and even leads a new group of evildoers with the best acronym joke in a show littered with them. The amount of subtle foreshadowing and continuity is also kind of impressive.
Or you could have made a gigantic slingshot and shot us back to the mainland.
Hey, not bad. Mind if we use that someday?
Ooh, you two are gonna be so busted.
You remember a few schemes ago when I couldn't figure out what big laundry meant? Well, this is what I meant!
Season 2 dives deeper into very specific forms of comedy that were somewhat rare in children's cartoons at the time. There's self-referential humor, like when one of Doofenshmirtz's backstories includes an alternate version of a pop song from Dude, We're Getting the Band Back Together.
How do you like that, Perry the Platypus? Love handle, in my flashback. I know people.
There's a lot more parody, with long gags that reference Citizen Kane and a full-on Wizard of Oz satire that ironically makes fun of how many songs are crammed into it.
I don't want nothing.
Okay, chop chop, fellas, time's a-wasting.
But I am reminded of a song. I want nothing.
There's also a lot of explicit fourth wall breaks, which are the most prominent in a musical remake of the pilot episode. It's got a little too much reused animation for my liking, but the songs are some of the strongest in the series catalog. If you play scenes from both episodes back to back, it's neat to see how far the characters and humor have already evolved.
Mom says I'm in charge conditionally.
Whatever.
Wait a minute, what are you doing?
Homework.
Mom says I'm in charge! Conditionally!
The condition didn't have anything to do with the moose, did it?
You know, it's funny that you mentioned that. Oh! I'm watching you!
Slowly but surely, we also see the focus of the A-plots shift from the invention of the day to Candace's teenage anxiety, usually over her crush on Jeremy. It's good to see Candace Potts move away from her strictly busting her brothers, as her escapades are typically the most unique and relatable aspect in an average episode. I also appreciate the clear growth in Candace and Jeremy's relationship throughout season 2. They go on a few legitimate dates and both struggle to impress each other. When Jeremy calls Candace his girlfriend and they share a kiss in one of the season's final episodes, it's a satisfying payoff that justifies all the awkwardness it took to reach that moment. Candace also stars in everyone's least favorite episode. Candace gets busted. Well, everyone's except mine. The ending where Candace wrongfully gets in trouble doesn't ruin the catchy song or hilarious Doofenshmirtz subplot. If you want an ending that undermines the rest of an episode, then direct your attention towards She's the Mayor. It's not very terrific for the most part, but the ending undoes everything that happened in a way that barely makes any sense. For me, this was the season with the most forgettable episodes, but this one just stuck out as the worst to me. I'd still call season 2 an improvement in every way, especially in the visual department. Phineas and Ferb just looks better when it's on model. The wacky symmetrical character designs now seem more normal, and more detail is put into the wild inventions of the stepbrothers. I think the best piece of animation they ever had is a 38-second panning shot from Doof's side of the moon. I don't know how impressive it is from a technology standpoint, but it's endlessly rewatchable for having so many inventive moving pieces in one place. Musically, I think season 2 is where the show peaked, as the songs cover the widest range of genres, from country to 80s rock, with quite a lot of these tunes being my all-time favorites, although I think they work best within the episodes that they can be first found in. However, I did spot two sneaky ways in which they were recycled. The Flawless Girl theme from Attack of the 50-Foot Sister sounds oddly similar to It's Candace from the previous season, even reusing the same background extras.
You know you want to be her, she's a flawless girl.
Flawless girl.
Who's that girl going down the street? It's Candace.
Also, do you remember that Go Phineas song I made fun of earlier? Well, replace Phineas with Candace, and you got the lone song from Fireside Girl Jamboree. Whether or not that's the show's worst song depends on what you define as a song or just a gag. Some of the half-hour episodes have very creative ways of splitting themselves up into different adventures that take place simultaneously or in the same specific location. But my favorite is Nerds of a Feather. It's got a great grasp on the tendencies in fandom culture to turn every debate into a war or treat someone as an outcast for liking something out of their target demographic. It also has Doof's best evil scheme yet, where he forces a TV executive voiced by Seth MacFarlane to listen to his pitch for a cheesy self-insert 80s action drama. I'd say it's the best in the season, at least if you don't count the last 11 minutes of the Summer Belongs to You special. It's so emotionally satisfying from start to finish, and the You Can't Stop the Beat tribute that caps it off probably would have been a great way to end Phineas and Ferb if the summer truly was to be 104 episodes long. But after traveling around the entire world in one day, where does the show go from here? Well, I feel obligated to tell you, in song! Oh, thank God I was cut off. I consider Across the Second Dimension to be the absolute highlight of the series. Every single aspect was kicked up a notch. The character animation is smoother and environments are brought to life with great lighting and detail. The action has room to breathe and includes sequences straight out of the Avengers films in more than one way. The score can be grandiose and intense when it needs to, and the songs are some of the best the show has ever produced, including one that was cut from the final version. No wonder I still own the soundtrack. Although it was a missed opportunity to not include Dr. Bowsheet's ditty about how traveling counterclockwise through dimensions would take 8 million gigawatts of energy overloading the local power grid.
If you travel through dimensions, going clockwise makes it easy. Going counterclockwise would take 8 million gigawatts of energy, overloading the local power grid. I know, it needs a chorus.
There's a ton of fan service in both the climax and in little details, like remnants of Alka agent lairs and tubes underground in the second dimension. The status quo is temporarily shattered when Phineas and Ferb find out about Perry's double life as a secret agent, and Phineas is relentlessly furious at his pet platypus for lying to him.
You're a secret agent?
It's jarringly out of character, but incredibly entertaining to see such an excessively optimistic and oblivious character turn his back on his pet so quickly. I feel that Phineas's confusion does come from an understandable place, so his overblown reaction only adds to the drama. I realize now that it was this movie in particular that shaped my love for sci-fi concepts like alternate dimensions, wacky dystopias, and the roboticization of heroes. It stands to be my favorite TV movie based on a cartoon, even though I must note that you won't get as much out of it as I have if you aren't already at least vaguely familiar with the format and characters of the series. On the flip side, it also would have been nice to see the events of the movie carry over into the show somehow, sequel episode notwithstanding, but I understand that this probably couldn't have happened unless this was the series finale. Regardless, the strong comedy and character development is enough to make Across the Second Dimension good on its own, but within the show itself, it's a brand new reality for Phineas and Ferb. Season 3 premiered at the height of the series' popularity, and it was everywhere, not only on all sorts of merchandise, but it also spawned a live show that proved these characters should be banned from the third dimension, and a short-lived talk show spin-off in the style of Space Ghost Coast to Coast, having the boys interview live-action celebrities. The final episode of Take 2 with Phineas and Ferb guest starred Guy Fieri, showing that some heroes just can't escape the temptations of Flavor Town.
Hey!
Yeah?
Hey!
Huh?
Hey!
What?
Hey, guys!
With a rapidly growing franchise behind it, there was a lot riding on the success of this season to keep Phineas and Ferb popular. And while some might not agree that it delivered on that goal, it is my favorite of the four seasons. I felt like overall it was the most creative and best written, especially because it fully embraces Candace and Dr. Doofenshmirtz as central characters. Candace has to jump through more hoops than ever to be Jeremy's girlfriend and bust her brothers, and Doofenshmirtz's schemes prove that he has a bone to pick with nearly everyone in the tri-state area. It also seems like he really got into BuzzFeed tests.
Look at you! You're just the bottom!
Over time, I got quite sick of how often the song in each episode would be a ditty that played over a montage of the stepbrothers' new invention, so I appreciated whenever it was sung by a side character or was worked into the episode in clever ways. Like in Candace Disconnected, the plot stops in its tracks for Doof and Perry to exercise for a minute. It's a random moment, but the episode would likely not be as well remembered without it. And no, it is not the only song in this season with unintentional romantic implications.
We both have our roles, this is a symbiotic relationship.
Season 3 also brought down the number of end credit scenes into the single digits. There's barely any extra verses or additional bits, and most of the time, we just get the last half a minute of the featured song. It also includes various episodes that I would classify as being gimmicky, although their execution was hit or miss. An episode from the prior season called The Chronicles of Meep ended with a trailer for a fake episode, and since everyone wanted to see it, one season later we got Meet Me in Seattle. It found clever ways to reincorporate all the cliche action movie shots from its trailer into a silly but captivating story. I can call it the highlight of the season due to its powerful sequences, like when Doofenshmirtz suffers the loss of his greatest friend, a balloon with a detailed human face drawn on it.
Think of all the good times we can have now that we...
Then there's a set of four episodes that were aired under the Time Shift Weekend event. They took the characters and plopped them into different time periods, fantasy settings, and movie parodies. These have their positives, but they were pretty bare bones and uninteresting. I recall feeling consistently dissatisfied whenever new episodes would premiere, since we would only get one or two new half-hour episodes every month. When I started watching it, I was used to consuming large chunks of this show at once, basically binging it through random reruns. When taking it all in during this rewatch, the simplicity and lackluster quality of episodes like Ferb TV and Agent Doof is a lot easier to excuse now. The only episode that disappointed me now as much as it did when it premiered was the Where's Perry two-part special, my least favorite from season 3. The background art is beautiful, and the Living with Monkeys song is undeservingly underrated. But Evil Carl is an underwhelming threat, and the way it builds to a climax was quite contrived. Having to wait a whole month for the lukewarm second part was disappointing in 2012, and it did not help the flow of the special today. Even though I'd say that season 3 had some of the weakest episodes yet, every single one had something clever and distinct about it, whether it included alien flamingos or animation of only eyeballs for 10 whole minutes. It brought a slightly experimental edge to Phineas and Ferb that it needed to stay fresh, and I'd say that most of it worked out. We even got an episode that featured nearly every fetish under the sun in one package, so clearly this wasn't a bad deal. Midway through season 4, I lost interest in the series. It might have had something to do with the season taking 30 months to air its 35 episodes. This was an issue that the show couldn't really get around, as the series wrapped production in December of 2014, 2 years after the season premiered, so they had to stretch out the time it took to air. I'm not sure if this was a fault of the network or the crew behind the scenes, but I stopped following the show around the time Steampunks came out. Yet another average time shift episode. It's too bad I missed out on most of the season, as it was certainly the biggest in the series history, and it went out with quite a bit of its dignity intact. With that being said, the first half is fairly unremarkable. Phineas and Ferb's inventions feel like they're at the forefront of far too many episodes, despite having become the show's weakest element. Sometimes their plots are entirely disconnected from the rest of an episode, and even an invention about building an obstacle course around recycled materials is straight up recycled in another episode. There isn't enough stuff like Mindshare, where the gang's adventures are taken to strange new places. Okay, there is an entire bee-themed musical number about 9-year-old girls twerking, but that's not what I meant. While I know the songs were never the top priority, the connection between them and the episode quality is stronger than ever. Like, do you remember Foam Town or the episode associated with it? I didn't think so. It's apparent in the storytelling that the writers were running low on ideas and just wanted this summer vacation to finally end.
I'm telling you, I'm dry, Perry the Platypus, dry, and this summer just keeps going on and on. It feels like it's been going on for like 4 years.
The front half of the season only really shines in its half-hour episodes. The winter and Halloween-themed segments are decent changes of pace, and Sidetracked proves that Perry's subplot can carry an episode, along with a little help from Samantha Bee, Canada jokes, and self-aware musical numbers.
To remove any confusion from ambiguous writing. This is people fighting on a helicopter, not two helicopters fighting.
Oh, though that would have been cool. Let's take a look.
There is one key exception to this point, and that's the second musical clip classic countdown. Phineas and Ferb is one of the few cartoons from the modern day that's done clip show episodes. I can't tell you if they were a network request or a product of the series going over budget, but they use this format to interact with fans, do specific jokes with the editing, or to have a one-stop shop for Doofenshmirtz backstory flashbacks. But season 4's clip show has the characters animated in Flash and superimposed on a green screen to have forced interactions with live-action Disney Channel stars. The selection of fan-voted songs is fine, but the painful wraparounds make this the worst episode in the season, and to me, the entire series.
And I can't believe this, but you all picked my favorite song as the number one song.
Lies, lies, lies.
I'm just a guy who's a sucker for the sounds of mass transit.
The traditional episode structure falls by the wayside over time to make room for episodes that begin to wrap things up. We get exciting follow-ups to characters like Klim Balloon, Dennis the Rogue Bunny, and even Doof's estranged father, who Dr. D has a bittersweet reunion with. Weirdly enough, just as many plot points are introduced without receiving conclusive resolutions. Stacy finds out about Perry's secret, and second dimension Doofenshmirtz escapes from prison in a follow-up to the TV movie. We didn't even get the third Meep episode that they had no intention of ever making. Perhaps the creators were banking on getting some sort of spin-off, as a few episodes reek of being backdoor pilots. Doof 101 sounds like a joke show that would have appeared in the Ferb TV episode, and the Alka Files has a great theme song, but too many characters I could care less about, including the three bugs that were cut from the original pitch of the series. And now I understand why. There's really no point to them being characters.
Wow, it's a good thing that lid didn't fall on us. That would have hurt.
Well, yes, Wendell, that was fortunate.
Various times, we also see Isabella wanting to get serious about spending time with or expressing her true feelings towards Phineas, all of which culminates in At Your Age, the penultimate episode that flashes forward to 10 years in the future. The story of how a fan artist was brought in to design the aged-up child characters is both inspirational and a great way to give back to the fans. In spite of this, the episode itself feels like a fanfic and how it forces Phineas and Isabella to accept the relationship between them, especially because we're given flimsy explanations for why every character has changed in the ways that they have. Like so many other episodes from the past two seasons, Act Your Age over-relies on its gimmick to carry the story instead of using its gimmick to tell an interesting story. Speaking of things that disappointed fans, the co-creator of Lost conceived an episode about the nemesis of Alka agent Peter the Panda, where he poked fun at his own work.
There better be a satisfying explanation for this when it's over, or I'm gonna be merciless on my blog.
It's gotta be the strangest episode of this show, but if you know what you're in for, it's not half bad.
Oh, hi, Dad. Mom has snacks if you want to join us.
Jolly good boys. I am a bit peckish.
Season 4 includes not just one, but 5 main hour-long specials. The Mission Marvel crossover is disliked for having Phineas get uncharacteristically angry at Isabella and Candace in a contrived attempt to include a girl empowerment moral, and its catalyst doesn't work as well as it did in Across the Second Dimension. Besides that, it's a fun romp that pays tribute to both properties, with great character combinations and obscure references to Howard the Duck and the sad Incredible Hulk music.
I've always told her, don't ever make Phineas angry. You wouldn't like him when he's angry.
The Star Wars crossover leans in even harder on the references, but has so much more fun reworking the characters into the events of A New Hope, a la Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are dead. It's like if the similar Family Guy Blue Harvest episode was written more for Star Wars fans than it was for Family Guy fans. Phineas and Ferb Save Summer puts the fate of the world at stake, but its conflicts involving Candace's fear of spiders and infighting within Love Muffin feel too small. It is the greatest argument for having more episodes that take place in fall and winter settings because, man, the backgrounds in this episode are gorgeous. The special that became my favorite of the season was Night of the Living Pharmacist, where the cast has to band together to survive a zombie infection of Doofenshmirtz lookalikes. The story is pulse-pounding but never gets too dark, and it brings so much together when crafting its thrilling finale. Last but not least, The Last Day of Summer is a fine Groundhog Day time loop tale, and the last 5 minutes are nearly perfect, but it doesn't really seem like a conclusive final outing for these characters that we've known for so long, especially when it's been undermined by something of an extended crossover. One year later, Disney XD premiered a spiritual successor to Phineas and Ferb that shared much of its creative team and art direction, Milo Murphy's Law. It follows a middle schooler whose life revolves around the mantra of whatever can go wrong, will go wrong, making Milo the yin to Phineas and Ferb's yang. It's revealed that the setting of both shows is one and the same, building up to a crossover that resolves a recurring story arc. In the fallout of this special, Doofenshmirtz Evil Incorporated is destroyed, and Dr. D crashes on the Murphy's couch for the rest of the season, making him a proper side character. It's intriguing to see Doof struggle to fulfill his destiny and become a good guy with Perry often at his side, but it does nothing to help Milo Murphy's Law establish its own identity, particularly because his escapades have little bearing on Season 2's overarching plot. If these characters are going to return, they shouldn't have to take over a different show to do it. That's why I'm looking forward to the new movie coming to Disney Plus within the next year, currently known to us as Candace Against the Universe. If they just need to bring it back, doing a standalone animated project is the way to go, though it's too bad that Milo may be getting the shaft in favor of this movie. I mean, if it wasn't going to be a thing, then the Alka Files would be the last thing produced only for the series, so I'm okay with this summer vacation lasting just a bit longer. After not touching it since it wrapped up, Phineas and Ferb continues to be one of my favorite cartoons from recent memory. It is living proof that sticking to a formula never equals lazy writing, and it tried to make the most out of all of its elements, just as its characters tried to make the most out of every day. Over time, it learned what did and didn't work, but I respect its attempts to mix things up and occasionally bring something bizarre to the table. But beyond the inventions and innators, there were great messages about cultural diversity, optimism and determination, and accepting your family. It had such an upbeat and positive spirit that offered a great escape into a world of magical realism. No matter what your age is, Phineas and Ferb is the perfect show to watch over the course of one full summer vacation, whether or not it's exactly 104 days long. Taking more or less time to binge it will either cause you to get burnt out, lose interest, or have quotes from the series integrated into your speaking patterns. It may not be an ideal way to seize the day for a few months, but was it worth it? Yes. Yes, it was.